We're now going to look at the question of leapfrogging and whether a point that was made in the opening panel today, what does that mean in practice? The comment was that, in fact, you should look at the areas of the world with weak incumbents and generally weak regulatory systems as the area where maybe the best innovation is going to happen, and that will then maybe take those economies ahead of where we are in the developed world. And to talk to us, I want to bring up Bob Diamond, who is founder and chief executive of Atlas Merchant Capital and former chief executive of Barclays. So Bob, please join us on the stage. And I wanted to start off by asking you, what drew you to Africa? What's your vision of banking in that environment?
So I think it's a little bit of a passion. Having lived in London for over 20 years, and we brought our children were born and raised there, we had an opportunity in that time zone to visit Africa for pleasure. But I think also one of the great gifts of being a part of Barclays for 16 years is that they had a franchise in 11 countries that date back 80, 85, 90 years, really a function of the empire. And in 2005, when they acquired the majority share of Absa, South African Bank, which they had given up South African banking during apartheid, it gave them a huge presence. And that was the first time that the board asked me to get involved. So it's also a little bit of experience. But if I come back to the world today, Africa rising, the sheer numbers in the population, the fact that the number of people in sub-Saharan Africa in that age group of 15 to 24 is almost as large as the entire population in our country. The emerging urbanization, emerging middle class, the growth of democracies, the growth of elections, I just think the opportunity in Africa is phenomenal from an economic point of view. And it will not be realized without serious investment, both in equity and in operating skills in the financial services industry.
And does this feel to you primarily a technology play?
No, I think it is a technology play. I think it's a huge part of it, but it's much more than that. There is access to credit for African consumers and African businesses that is so necessary to really get this economic growth, this promise going down the road. Technology plays a huge part of that. But there's also, I think there's a lot of other things, like just the sophistication of helping farmers hedge out the crops from the next year and the year after, so they're not living from year to year and suffering the vagaries of the price changes. So,
but where do you see, look forward to the growing of this banking sector in Africa, where do you see the key differences being in how that model will look compared to the traditional banking industry that you've come out of?
So it starts with, what is the model today? And I think I'm going to generalize this. This is an oversimplification, so I apologize, but it's not a massive oversimplification. But for the domestic banks in the 46 countries that make up sub-Saharan Africa, really everywhere other than South Africa, which is really consolidated, the typical banking model is to take a deposit, pay very, very little to the person giving you that deposit, buy a domestic T-bill that yields 13, 14, or 15%, and with 1,000 to 1,500 basis points, you don't have to be particularly efficient, so it's a very manual processing system, and it doesn't do anything to get lending to consumers or lending to businesses. So it starts with a very simple business model. But I think on the more positive side, one of the biggest impediments for the most successful banks in the US, the UK, and Europe today is the cost base, the legacy systems, the complexity of technology. And Africa has an opportunity with the cloud and the amazing impact that the cloud has had on the cost of developing technology and the cost of running technology to truly leapfrog the legacy technology and move forward. And Matthew, I don't think it's just on the mobile phone. I don't think it's just on money transmission. I think it's also on the infrastructure side of how we manage data, how we manage information, and how we run an efficient organization. So I think if you take a medium to long-term view, I think the opportunity in investing in financial services in Africa is like nowhere else.
So what have been your initial moves there to build on that vision?
So I think step one is to test the vision. And the vision that we have and the plan we have is a little bit bold, but it's really clear. Our mission is to be the leading sub-Saharan Africa financial institution. When we say that and lay out what it means, the test to that is, can you raise equity? And we're able to raise equity in an IPO on the London Stock Exchange in the end of 2013 with that vision. So I think a lot of people buy the vision. The second test is, okay, can you actually acquire banks? I mean, can you imagine trying to do this in India or China? Great opportunities economically, but they're not open to foreign investment, and they're certainly not open to foreign investment in a majority position. And so in our first year, we did four deals, all closed. We're in seven countries, and I love to talk about our first deal there, which was the acquisition of Bank ABC. It was in five countries, Botswana, Zimbabwe, Zambia, Mozambique, and Tanzania. 40% of the equity was owned by a publicly listed private equity firm in Frankfurt, Germany. And to think that we had that transaction and all regulatory approvals completed in less than 5 months and the branch is open for business. The lesson I learned from that was, it was probably the most complex transaction. It's definitely the most complex transaction I've ever done in my career, and hopefully it will be the most complex one I ever do. And it was closed in 5 months with six different regulators, including the German regulators, which means they're open for business. And I think the big change for us is the decision, which was a tough one to make, which was to raise money in equity before we had any assets, a SPAC, a special purpose acquisition vehicle. But I think the fact that we went into the regulators and the political leaders with permanent equity and the recognition that we had a team that really knew how to operate was very different than a private equity minority investment where the LPs have to be paid back after a certain amount of time. So I think it was critical to the heads of state and to the regulators that we were seen as permanent equity and permanent players.
Now talk a bit about the mobile phone and the potential there, though. I mean, how far ahead do you think Africa could get? Because it essentially will be doing its banking via smart devices.
Well, you know, it's something like there's numbers all over the place. So you take them as kind of an order of magnitude. But somewhere between 75 and 85% of the people in sub-Saharan Africa, in most of the countries, somewhere on that order, have never been in a branch. So if you have never been in a branch, what is the chance that you're going to do branch-based banking? On the other hand, we're seeing a rapid movement towards cities and urbanization. And if you are living in a city and coming from far out of a city, you are more likely to, particularly if you're a small business, to use a branch in technology. Again, it's just a number, but about half of every money transmission that happens by a mobile phone every day comes from Kenya. Now think about that. That's not from Africa, it's from Kenya. From one country in Africa, about half of the money transmission transactions come. One of the reasons—
And well, that may be a problem, though, isn't it? That hasn't spread far enough to other—
And it's interesting why Kenya hasn't moved aggressively out. And one of the reasons isn't a great one, is they have a monopoly telecom provider, so it's a little bit easier to control. But it does show the potential, and I think they estimate that the next 5 or 6 years, what we're looking for is the dramatic change, is the move from mobile phones to smartphones. And the numbers are phenomenal, and the services available are phenomenal. I think there's something on the order of 150 million internet.
So what does shifting to the smarter phone do in terms of something like M-Pesa and your ability to use that as a plan?
Well, I think for the banks, for the clients, it gives them much more sophisticated services. And I think the next leg of this is to move from moving money. If I want to give you money, or preferably you want to give me money, that's not a banking transaction. But if you get into corporate lending and some of the other things, a full regulated banking environment, I think it's going to It's going to improve the chances that the banks can become more competitive with the telecom companies, and that services move beyond moving money into banking.
Now, obviously, a lot of the technologies are available to big banks in big economies that are very well developed. And this notion of leapfrogging would, I guess, have the situation where a bank could come out of Africa with better able to compete on the global stage than maybe a Barclays, which is, or a JP Morgan, which is trying to innovate whilst dealing with its legacy businesses. I mean, do you think that's going to happen, and how quickly?
I'll tell you what, the challenges within Africa are so great, I haven't even given that any thought at all. But I will say that there's technology in many, many ways. So when I was at Barclays, one of the technology advances we made in Cape Town was with Barclaycard. And the simple move in the busing system in Cape Town to a cashless system. You know, people thought of it as ease, you don't have to carry money. But the entire public transportation system became cashless. So the only way to pay for the bus was to have a pay-as-you-go card. Now, interestingly, the real reason for that had nothing to do with people don't want to carry money. It had to do with security. And it had to do with the fact that they don't want cash sitting on the bus. So I say that in the sense of the incredible opportunities for the development of a more innovative and more creative environment. And on the other hand, bringing credit card technology to Africa is bringing nothing that's particularly innovative from a banking sense, but it's massively innovative from an African sense. So we don't have to be dreaming a lot of new things to be able to develop a much more sound and much more progressive financial services industry in Africa. We just have to apply them in a better way.
And you mentioned the sort of massive challenges. I mean, what would be your top two or three practical challenges that you're engaging with at the moment?
I would say probably the single biggest challenge for our ambition, which is to be a sub-Saharan African bank, not just a bank for any one country, there's 46 countries in sub-Saharan Africa. About 11% of trade, this is hard to believe, but this number is accurate, about 11% of trade in Africa is intra-Africa. If you were talking about the Eurozone, probably 60% of trade would be intra-Eurozone. And so in Africa, more than anywhere else, it should be at the high end of this. It should be 60, 70, 80%. And so much of the reason is infrastructure. You know, lack of consistency in terms of moving between, you know, visas and moving between countries, highways, transportation. And one of the really positive developments in sub-Saharan Africa is the development of trading blocks. So the SADC region in southern Africa, East African Community, where President Kagame of Rwanda and President Kenyatta are really, and a number of the other leaders are really serious about breaking these barriers down. Barriers around roads, transportation, visas, and to really encourage trade. And so I'm moving beyond your question, but I would say the number one issue is infrastructure. Closely associated with that is the difficulty of getting lending into small businesses with a combination of the very, very high interest rates on domestic T-bills. So if you're getting 15% in a domestic currency T-bill, at what rate are you willing to take the extra risk to lend to a small business? And so that's going to take a system like, you know, in 1938 when we developed Fannie Mae in the U.S. to take that credit guarantee to get mortgages into consumers in the U.S. We need something in Africa that is going to encourage the governments to take some of the credit risk so that banks can be encouraged to lend.
In a nutshell, the reason that they're able to, that the interest rates are so high on the T-bills is what?
In the domestic, because of the economy, and it's a very good point. If you believe in the thesis of Africa rising, and if you believe in the economic growth, and if you believe in the political stability, then T-bill REITs aren't going to stay at 14 or 15 or 16%. They're going to come down. And that's why we feel at Atlas Mara that really working with the heads of state and public policy and the development agencies such as the African Development Bank to force lending to consumers and to businesses is something that's very positive because all the banks are going to have to get there eventually. And another thing that's happening, this is a very banking nuance thing, but the Central Bank of Nigeria under former Governor Sanusi began forcing this by increasing the amount of capital that banks would have to hold if they bought a T-bill, forcing them into the market. But the challenge of getting money into small businesses, I would say, is one of the biggest challenges we have.
I just wanted to ask the last question. I mean, where do you, if someone from Silicon Valley came to you and said, I'm thinking of going to Africa to start a fintech startup, would you say good idea? And would you say, where would you point them in terms of where the opportunities are greatest?
I'd say, come join us at Atlas Mara. We'll do a joint venture.
That's dodging the question. Go on, ask me, which part of the economy would you?
Which country?
No, which country, which bit of, where do you see the opportunities?
Nigeria. Let's cut to the chase. I think Nigeria is challenging, but the size of the economy, the demographics, I think the fact that Nigeria has just had the first peaceful transfer of leadership through election in the history of the country, the new president, Buhari, the focus he has on selecting the right people with the right background and the right reputation for
eventually.
His government. It's taking him a while, but it looks like he's getting the right people. I think the opportunity for Nigeria is phenomenal. Let me just give you a kind of a sense of it. Brazil's not as good an example as I used to use when I gave this example before there was a crash in Brazil. But when Brazil had emerged, it emerged as the fifth largest population in the world. Nigeria in the next about 10 years, maybe less, will pass Brazil as the fifth most populous country in the world. At its peak, the market cap of banking in Brazil was about $300 billion was the market cap of the financial services industry. In Nigeria today, it's about 10 or 12 billion. So the opportunity of that economy versus the size of financial services doesn't compute unless there's serious investment and serious progress in developing both branch banking, but more importantly, mobile banking in Nigeria. We're not going to achieve those dreams.
Great. Well, Bob, that perfectly sets up the rest of the panel discussion. So I'll ask them to join you up here. I'd like to bring up Matt Flannery, who is now co-founder and board member of, he's the founder of Branch.co and was the founder and co-founder of Kiva, the online lending site. We've got Jalak Jobanpatur, who's the founding partner of Future Perfect Ventures. And last, by no means least, Teo Oviosu, founder and chief executive of Paga. And I want to start with our two entrepreneurs and then turn to you, Jalak, from an investor perspective. But we've just been hearing about the opportunity in Nigeria. Just tell us, in practice, you know, what about Paga and the challenges that you've faced and how it's going and why you're optimistic, as I assume you are, about Nigeria.
No, I'm absolutely optimistic. First of all, thank you very much for having me here. And I was really glad to hear, you know, the good things about Nigeria. I think, you know, people don't understand the sheer size and opportunity that Nigeria really holds. You know, not only is it the largest country on the continent, it's the largest economy. And I actually think at $520 billion GDP, it's actually understated. And it's actually much, much larger than that. If you compare that to the United States, I think it's, you know, the GDP of Nigeria and the share size is actually bigger than most of the states you would invest in, or you'd invest in companies in those states. So as a practical matter, there are only 36% of Nigerian adults that are banked. Now, what this presents is an opportunity to actually bring financial services, leveraging technology, to the mass market. And that's exactly what I went after in 2009 with Paga. So we're a mobile payment service in Nigeria that allows you to go into, think of it as a 7-Eleven or a neighborhood store, an agent, and actually perform a variety of financial services. You can go there and send money to anyone in Nigeria instant real time. You can send money to any bank account. You can pay for goods and services, pay for electricity, pay for your telephone, et cetera. Or you can do all of that by yourself from your mobile phone, any basic mobile phone. And so this is the service we started in 2009, and we're now the leading player with over 3.5 million users on the platform and growing quite rapidly. And there's a lot of innovation you can build on top of that ecosystem. Some of the things that Matt here is doing is an example that would leverage the last mile that we're creating in Nigeria. And so we're
just
very
talk
excited.
A bit about the practicalities, though, of setting this.
So first of all, it took us 2 years. When you think of regulation, it took us 2 years to get our license in Nigeria. If I were in the US, I'd have to get a license in every state, and I probably wouldn't have visited any of the regulators except maybe one or two, right? So that's, first of all, tough on the regulatory side, helping the regulators understand technology, understand the future, and then the banking side, right, as well. And then finally, on the investment side, I mean, most investors, especially here in the US, I came from Cisco, I was in the corporate development team, are not thinking Africa, right? And are just not thinking Nigeria yet. And so raising funds is also very, very challenging for this.
Then you had to go out store by store, essentially.
Yeah, and so then to build out our agent network, it's a field force. So we have about 110 people on my team who are out recruiting and managing the agents. And you have to go store by store, recruit, train, get people on. But the beauty of Nigeria is it's a very entrepreneurial country. And so the 8,000 plus agents that we have are all men and women that are entrepreneurs and see the business opportunity because they make money on everything you do at the store. And so that's very challenging. And managing that network is probably our biggest headache, right? But it's one that we do because if we do that, then we can go work with Bob and his bank, right? And say, come leverage our agent network, right?
So Matt, I mean, just you were at Kiva for a long time, which was all about getting people in rich countries to lend money to small entrepreneurs in the developing world. And now you've started this new operation called Branch. Tell us about Branch.
All right, well, yeah, thanks. And it's great to be here with such an amazing group of people. So a quick story of my last 10 years. I started Kiva in Uganda in 2005. Skip forward a number of years, I'm out working in the field in Kenya, visiting borrowers, and one thing I notice is increasingly the borrowers that I am visiting have mobile technology, and no longer do I need to reach them through a microfinance nonprofit on the ground, but I can reach them directly through mobile money. And even more recently, with the rise of Android, there's just so many opportunities to access, you know, the billions of people in the Southern Hemisphere that are coming online for the first time through Android and through mobile money. So after being the CEO of Kiva for 10 years, being a little bit tired of that, I took some time off and prototyped this new startup that I just launched 6 months ago. So we're making small loans, and the vision is to be a branchless bank, like a bank in your pocket on an Android device. And we use a lot of data science and a lot of trust networks and social dynamics to make small loans to people. I think the main thing I've learned is just how huge the demand is for a product like this. So if any of you are working in emerging markets, they're completely underserved by the banks there. And so there's a huge opportunity whenever you put an ad up on Facebook or a tweet, it just gets so much traction and so many downloads because everyone needs access to modern finance.
What's the basic product that you're providing then?
We're providing loans from $10 to $1,000, 4 weeks to 6 months. So we're trying to be, in a sense, a digital MFI.
And how quickly is quick decision?
Oh yeah, it's instant. So we built a robot. I'm a computer scientist. We built a robot in the sky that it acts like a loan officer and makes quick loan decisions instantly. If you're sitting at a bar on Friday night and you want 10 bucks, you can just get 10 bucks in 3 minutes. You can gamble on soccer. We have a lot of people gambling on soccer. We thought that was a negative for credit scoring, but it turned out to be a positive for some reason. The robot favors people that gamble for some reason. So a lot of counterintuitive, when you turn decision-making from humans to a machine and it's acting completely rational, there's a lot of counterintuitive things that occur.
So Jala, can you tell us a bit about your vision in fintech and where Leapfrog countries and technologies fit in compared to investing in more developed economies?
Sure. So a few months ago, or actually more than a few months ago, I wrote a blog post called When Third is First. And what I've seen through, been investing now for 17 years, and she ran a fintech company here in New York in 97. We're seeing business models kind of emerging in the developing world that are now coming to the US. And telemedicine is an example of that. But where I'm seeing a lot of innovation is really in the financial services world. And applications, given that, you know, A, the telecom infrastructure isn't, you know, in place. So we all know about how these markets have leapfrogged to mobile, bypassed the PC. But if you look specifically at financial services, I mean, over 50% of the world is still unbanked. And these are growing economies. These are economies that are going to be a larger and larger percentage of GDP. Of global GDP in the future, very young populations. So, you know, if you look at the millennials here, if you look at it just in the US, they are helping create new business models and new usage. But now you have you know, billions of folks around the world who are under the age of 25 who have known nothing else than mobile money and mobile transactions, and they're going to have more purchasing power, and they don't have, they're not being served by the banking system. So I think that provides tremendous opportunity for startups to you know, to listen or see how usage is occurring, see where the needs are, and create companies that are going to be, you know, significant companies of the future.
So as we look at Pargo or Branch, you know, do you see those being alternatives to a traditional banking system? I mean, do you imagine that whatever Bob is doing, you know, is really going to have much interaction with what you guys are doing, or is there going to be a coming together of the banking system and what you're doing?
Yeah, no, I definitely think there's a coming together. Because I don't sit here thinking the banks, and I think someone on the previous panel made the point, I don't think the banks are going to disappear. I think the banks will remain. I think we'll have new sort of structures. I mean, I can see Paga one day becoming a bank, and see Branch one day having a banking license. But the point is, even with that, we will still work with the banks, because A, right now in Nigeria, if you take our network of agents as an example, we have 8,500 agents. We have more active physical points of presence than all the banks in Nigeria put together, right? And I think there's still a need where the customers are for physical interaction with somebody. And I think that future is a branchless network. So I think the banks will still exist, but they'll leverage services like ours to, as a distribution arm, to reach the mass market. And that doesn't stop us from doing services like credit lending and things like that that banks typically do. But there's a lot more the banks do that we just are not going to go into. So I think there'll always be a role for the banks.
I think what'll happen is banks are really good at having a global infrastructure. They're really good at regulation and scale. But startups are very good at brand and customer service and innovation and taking risks because they're not as regulated. They don't have the legal team necessary to have a bank. And so we can do a lot of innovative stuff and learn, and banks can learn from us, and we can partner in a way. And so when you think of, you know, Visa's technology company, but usually on your Visa card, there's the name of your bank right behind it. It's powered by Wells Fargo, Bank of America, whatever. And I think we'll see a lot of innovative partnerships. Because startups like Pocketech or Branch are good at getting new customers, and banks want that.
Well, when you just brought up regulation, I think you know, a lot of these startups can also leapfrog regulation, and we're starting to see that where banks and traditional banks have a significant regulatory framework, and some of it's really not necessary in current market environments, and so, you know, one of the areas I've been investing in pretty significantly is in the blockchain, and I know there have been a few panels around that. And I'm not saying that there won't be any regulation in the sector, but I think there's going to be a rethinking of what regulation is necessary when you have, you know, these pipes that are these trusted pipes where we don't need some of the legacy intermediaries that we've.
So talk about the businesses today. There that you've invested in. Where are you seeing the potential for a blockchain business to do well in Africa?
Yeah, so well, BitPesa is a portfolio company, and they are based in Nairobi. They're also expanding to other markets in Africa, and. You know, we know that remittances are a huge cost, especially to regions such as Africa. So they have reduced, by using the blockchain, reduced the cost of remittances, brought it down to 3% versus the 12% that you know, some of the legacy remittance networks charge. And also finding that multinationals are using the BitPesa network to transfer capital, pay their employees into the region. And so it's really worked as an alternative to you know, traditional banking and provided lower cost services than the banks do in the region. I've also invested in companies like Blockstream, which is based in Montreal and the Valley, but they're building out the infrastructure around the blockchain so that we can have more instantaneous transactions, and I think that will also really benefit regions such as Africa, where you know you don't want to see a lag in the transactions, and that you know that's something that you know banks have been able to address through some of the infrastructure they have. So I'm looking at it very holistically, and I think some of the greatest potential is going to be in places like Africa.
So Bob, I mean, this, you have to deal as a regulated institution. I mean, how much does that hold you back from doing some of the things that maybe some of the other panelists may be able to do where they don't have as much you know, legacy regulation to deal with?
Well, I think everything that's happening and everything that's been said here is phenomenal. It's going to give consumers more choice. It's competition. Competition always makes people smarter and work harder. I kind of agree that who knows how the model ends, but it's probably not going to be at one end of the extreme or the other. There's going to be combinations. There's going to be sectors developed. I mean, one of the things that I find fascinating is sitting here in New York City, I think it was somewhere around 20 or 30 years ago was the first time I figured out you could go into a restaurant, have this fabulous meal, nice glass of wine, give them this green card, and then go out without giving them any money. And that little machine got like 10% or 1% or something. The prices of that haven't changed today. You know, 30 years later, we're still doing the same thing. That's going to get invaded. There's just too much spread there. And I think it's competition like this that is going to do it. So I think Africa is a phenomenal opportunity. The regulatory pressure that the US banks and the UK banks are feeling right now isn't the kind of regulatory pressure we feel in Africa. I think the regulators are welcoming innovation. They're welcoming investment. They're welcoming operators, people that really want to roll up their sleeves. And I'm inspired by these kinds of things. We're investing a lot of money to compete with all of them. We're doing it out of Kigali, which I think was an interesting choice for our team of where would we put our mobile technology investment within Africa? Where's the best environment?
Presumably Rwanda, the attraction of Rwanda is very, very high investment in
very business friendly. They really encourage investment.
But it's a small economy.
Financial center, but it's a small economy. So hopefully over the next few years, we'll be doing a lot of competition. But I think this is what drives innovation and ultimately what drives you know, value for consumers.
But as you chose Kigali, I mean, what did you look at Nairobi or you looked at Lagos? And
it was Kigali, right?
You know, I think Kagame, in some ways, to me, has become a verb. If you want to, if you want to Kagame a country, it means focusing on women's rights, focusing on education, focusing on business, focusing on, you know, getting everyone involved. And I think he's created an environment that you feel that it, you can invest money and work really hard, and you're going to get rewarded.
I want to Kagame something. Sounds good. Sounds fun.
And do you think it matters? I mean, he's supposed to step down. I mean, if he doesn't step down or whatever, does that change the business risk of everywhere under?
We'll see.
Do you think he won't step down?
I think the impact, I think there's a lot of focus on whether he extends his term or not. And I think what the focus ought to be on is you have this tiny, landlocked country. It's tiny. It's hard to find on the map. It's got no water anywhere around it. 20 and a half years ago, it went through probably the most brutal period of time of any country. And today, it's the only country in the world that in the last decade was one of the 10 fastest growing countries in the world. And this decade is one of the 10 fastest growing countries in the world. We ought to be applauding what's happening there.
So, Teo, just to, do you want to respond? I mean, you didn't choose Kigali.
No, I didn't. I did choose it to get married, though. I got married there last year. So it's a beautiful country. I absolutely recommend you go there.
Is that because of Kagame?
And Kagame did send someone to our wedding, which was surprising
in
to me.
Vacation tips on this panel.
But seriously, I think the bigger point is what you see on the TVs about African countries, and especially Nigeria, is not the reality on the ground. I had a cushy job at Cisco. I could have been one of the venture firms, and I chose to go back, not just because I'm Nigerian, but because I believe in the opportunity that exists, and I want to be part of that. So I think my message really here is, you know, when you think of the valley and the street, is there's actually a real investment opportunity that people are missing out on right now. And I think the likes of Tim Draper, the likes of Jim O'Neill, Bob, who've made investments in the region, are going to see that pay off phenomenally, right? And so, especially in financial services, right? People don't want to know what blockchain is, don't want to know what Bitcoin is. In fact, we rarely even use the term mobile money or mobile payments. They just want to know, I want to send money to someone, right? How do I do that? I want to pay for my electricity and I don't want to stand in line for 3 hours. How do I do that? And once they start using it, I mean, we're growing at 150% compounded annual growth rate, right? I mean, it's really, really phenomenal as people just sort of start picking these things up. And so I think the story is not being told well enough yet to show the real opportunity on the ground in these markets.
Right.
Go ahead.
I was just saying, I mean, the pent-up demand, I mean, there are not that many places left in the world where there's pent-up demand for so many different services, and I mean, and even beyond, you know, financial Ooh. Services.
Yeah.
So as an investor, you know, it's just so exciting to see. I actually don't mind that other folks are not investing because that provides opportunity, you know, for those of us that are. But I think partly because of the way the media portrays the continent, it's still amazing how many, you know, otherwise really intelligent folks don't really understand what's happening on the ground and what this pent-up demand represents in terms of growth and revenue and profits for the future.
One quick question, I'm gonna moderate for a sec. I'm taking over. So I quit my job at Kiva, a year ago, and I traveled the world and studied these ideas, and I met some funders at conferences along the way. And I was telling, pitching VCs, and one of them said, what are you gonna do? I said, well, I'm gonna do this in East Africa and Africa. And he's like, don't do that. You'll never raise money. It was one of the, and not that this unnamed VC thought it was a bad idea. He's like, that will probably work, but no one will fund it because there are no exits. Mm-hmm. And you are a funder. You have raised a lot of money for an African company. So I'm wondering how you think about exits in an African context or emerging market context, and how do your funders think about that?
Well, I don't view it as any different than a lot of other emerging markets, like India. I've invested a lot in India over the years, and that was something people said for a very long time. And now you're seeing, multi-billion dollar companies come out of there that are still not, and you still don't have those exit opportunities. There's a confidence that's grown in the market, and it's just been told in a way that's you know, it's a country versus a continent. So I, you know, it's a big country versus a continent. So
if Pocketbook gets big, would there be an IPO? Would it sell to somebody? Does that happen? Are there examples of that? A track record?
There are examples coming up on it. I mean, this year, so the largest, probably the largest fund investing on the continent is a company called Helios out of London. And they've had like two exits this year. They exited this year, Equity Bank in Kenya was a great deal for them. And they have, you know, the first probably Nigerian $1 billion IPO coming up next year in London with InterSwitch. Mm. That's definitely gonna be a $1 billion exit for, you know, valuation. And I think these things are gonna start showing that there's real opportunity in these markets, right? So you already have private equity firms like Actis who are selling their stakes, and they sold their stakes in Diamond Bank. I think actually the bank that Bob bought, somebody else was exiting, right? Or others have participated as well. So I think you're seeing some secondaries.
And how hard a sell was it for you, Bob, to get to raise that money before you?
You know, it's interesting. Carlyle, David Rubenstein's a good friend, and, and about 6 months before we decided to raise equity, I was talking to him about their experience, and they have quite a big fund for Africa, specialized Africa fund, not necessarily financial services. But what he was saying to me is after 3 years, I think, they were at about $500 million, and they had not a single penny from U.S. investors. And I found that, in a way, disarming. But having spent 20-plus years in London, I kind of understood it. You know, our kids were on safari 3 or 4 times, you know, an Easter vacation and other things. It's not a natural from here. It's just so hard to get there. Mm. So we thought a lot about it. And interestingly, and I think this is a really, really positive thing, that December, 5 months later, we did an IPO on the London Stock Exchange. We had a target of $250 million. We raised $325 million in equity with no assets, just cash, which is getting your exit before you get in.
Okay. I think I understand that.
90% of our investors were Americans, and 90% of those, it was their first investment in Africa. And I think it told me a lot. I think the fact that it had the big board of the London Stock Exchange, which has certain governance around it that everyone understands. It's not, I'm not sure where the Botswana Stock Exchange might be. So it took away a lot of the mystery. And I think the fact that it was equity, even though we won't have much liquidity for a few years, gave it the feeling that it wasn't a blind pool. So I think that there's ways, but one of the biggest challenges that I, not challenges, one of the things I truly enjoy is being a part of introducing opportunities in Africa to Americans.
Right. Yeah, and I would say, you know, private equity is pretty established in Africa. I mean, venture is just starting to look at Europe these days. So, you know, venture has been a very localized business.
It's a great market.
For so long. Again, that's where I certainly see the opportunity. I was born in Nairobi, and I've spent a lot of time in Africa. So it's a market I'm very comfortable with.
I wanted to push you a bit, Mass, in terms of, I mean, the quality of data in the developing world, you know, obviously much of the attraction of some of the new models that have succeeded over here, Lending Club, et cetera, is the ability to really data mine and discover better ideas of who's a good risk and so forth. I mean, your experience in Africa, how have you found interesting patterns in the data apart from these people who like to gamble on the soccer?
Yeah, you know, there's a big article coming out in the Wall Street Journal about this, maybe Thursday or Friday, and it'll be controversial. Because it's an unregulated market, you can do so much more with data than you can in the US. So the lending clubs and Wangas, they've used data in a very, very innovative way to improve the lending markets here, but they are very constrained by state lending laws or, you know, European lending laws, which, you know, disallow you to use rich data sets to make credit decisions because of potential redlining issues. There's no lending license that you could even get in Kenya. I tried to get a lending license. They told me it doesn't exist. If you're lending your own money, you can do anything. So we're trying to get as much data we can off the Android phone, call log, call history, SMSs, you know, mobile money receipts, Facebook data, location, all this stuff, put it into, you know, big data warehouses using graph databases and, you know, other machine learning techniques. And the machine does much better than people at picking.
So any surprising indicators apart from this gambling?
didn't really get to your question. Well, one thing that's interesting is I don't know if this is very surprising, but we're finding that people that are, you know, in their 40s are generally better borrowers than people in their 20s right now. We're finding people that have Facebook friends over 100 are a great credit risk compared to people that have Facebook friends under 100. We're finding that people in certain locations, no mystery, Nairobi, they have more money than people in other places. People that have satellite TV are very good borrowers. So something around this 40-year-old Nairobi urban person that has satellite TV is the best borrower.
What about gender?
Yeah, we're finding right now we don't actually capture gender, but anecdotally, if you look across it, we're finding that in general, men are paying back their loans at a higher performing than women. It's probably just because, in general, credit worthiness correlates to income in a very male-dominated society.
And what sort of performance are you getting on the loans? Are you getting most people repaid?
Yeah, so we started off lending to everyone, and we let the machine learn. And so if you lend to anyone in any society, you'll probably get about 80% of the people paying back. So that's the baseline. And then the machine learned and learned and learned and learned, and now it's down to about actually 5% default rate at this moment. So we just set it free. It's amazing.
Yeah, Bob, you wanted to come in on this.
Two things. One, to your question on gender, we found years ago when I was at Barclays, one of the things that we tried to do to give back was to get out way away from where the branches were and set up lending in the community. And literally lending in a tin box, where it started with savings and it went eventually to insurance and to lending. In a tin box, weekly meeting.
Wow.
And it was 100% dominated by the women in the village.
Right.
The men weren't allowed to get near the tin box.
Yeah, and I come from a microfinance world. Yeah. And so all my examples for 10 years were, women pay back their loans way better than men.
I'm surprised at that, yeah.
But, you know, if you think about it, it's credit scoring is essentially an exercise in, you know, estimating someone else's income and how much money they'll have in a month, how much money they'll have in 6 months. So in a society like Kenya, men are, you know, got the jobs, men are in power
The other thing I wanted to say, and I think we found this fascinating, but in the first 6 months that we actually had control of Bank ABC, so again, five countries in the SADC region, in the first 6 months of that business, and what we did leading up to it is we did an end-to-end restructuring and evaluation of the credit process. But in the first 6 months, we had higher loans, lower non-performing loans, better collections. And we're seeing that trend continue. It's really, it's not hard to do. It just, you know, you have to put the processes in.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the feeling that in Africa one can't collect bad debts or one can't assess credit is overstated.
All right, let's take some questions. We'll come, the gentleman in the middle there. There's a microphone coming, I hope. If you'd say who you are. Yeah, it's coming from behind you there. In the middle here, the blue top, blue shirt. And then there's a gentleman down the front. And there's someone down here as well, on the right. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Danny Shader from PayNearMe. We do something similar to PogUp in the United States. Problem we don't have is that our receivables all come from corporate 7-Eleven, and I heard you mention you have to go out and collect, you have to go sign up all these shops individually. How do you manage receivables risk?
Yeah, so good question. The way our system works is it's pretty much prepaid. So all our agents have to first fund their Paga wallet with us. So whenever someone comes to them to perform, let's say they want to pay for their Comcast, right, or equivalent, they give the agent cash, and the agent performs the transaction for them off their own wallet. So we've already collected money, and we pay Comcast, and we've collected our fee as well. Interestingly, recently we just introduced credit to this as well. So now we, for some of our agents, we give them a credit advance as well.
Yeah. How does that compare to the US? Oh, we got the microphone behind you again.
Yeah, one of the ways we keep our costs down against the incumbent money transmitters who typically rely on bodegas is to deal only with national store chains where we have a receivable is from the store chain, not from the franchisee, and therefore we don't have any receivables risk as a practical matter. But there are certainly others. I think Western Union MoneyGram, when they sign up the local liquor store, they're doing some sort of underwriting of that entity.
Question down here.
Hi, Thomas Yankovic with Deloitte in the US, recently from
South Africa, doing some work with your former firm, Bob. Big exam question for any of you is, who's going to leapfrog M-Pesa, given the fact that technology has been advancing, mobile penetration has been advancing, cost of telephony and devices have been decreasing, and no one has actually replicated the success beyond Kenya and M-Pesa's founded in 2007?
The leapfrogger is on this panel. But I can't tell you which one.
I would probably
he's going to do it.
I would disagree with the premise. You know, look, we've been going for just about 3+ years, and almost 4 years, and you know, we're growing at a pace. Actually, if you compare our pace of growth to M-Pesa's when it started, we're actually growing faster than M-Pesa grew. We have over 8,000 agents. In 3 years, M-Pesa had the same 8,000 agents, and they had a dominant position, right, in a country the size of Lagos State in Nigeria, right? So I think we've actually proved that.
Do you think M-Pesa will turn out to be one of these things that we all got excited about, but is
completely? I think
quite
so.
Misleading.
I mean, last year my co-founder was like, "Ty, I'm surprised you've never been to Kenya to go see M-Pesa," and I'm like, "I don't even think about them, right?" I mean, like, it's such a problem in a small country. That doesn't have the challenges that we faced. We're 4 mobile network operators in Nigeria. Till today, we're still not on the second largest mobile network operator. The largest one, MTN, refused us to come on for 2 years. The day they agreed, it took us half a day, right? I mean, so we've actually, in a much tougher environment, proven that you can actually build this business.
Don't you think the winner in the end won't have agents? Don't you think agents sounds kind of old-fashioned? Like, PayPal doesn't have agents all across New York.
So PayPal doesn't have agents all across New York because you have bank accounts, right, and you have banks that people are dealing with. So I actually, the way our system works, we don't care about the source of the money or what, we just want to affect the transaction. So I think you will have physical presence for a long time.
Because you would eventually have ATMs here.
You have ATMs.
Right, but I mean, that's kind of my point. Don't you think ATMs will take over?
So
you won't have to have agents.
Sure. So for example, today you can send money on Paga and pick up at an ATM without a card. So this is the other thing about technology. You know, I think all this technology exists here, but it's not being used, right? So I was sitting here and I just sent money to a bank in Nigeria, instant real time, right? And the money gets into the account. If I sent money to someone, they can go pick up at an ATM, they can go to an agent to pick it up. But I think when it comes to
certain... But they get money out of an ATM without a card?
Without a card, yeah. So you go to the ATM and you say cardless transaction, and it asks you for 3 pieces of information that we've sent to you in an SMS. And you put that in and you get the cash, right? So will cash go away one day? I absolutely believe it will. But I think for a long time, we'll still have cash. And people still just want to affect whatever transaction that they want.
Yeah, I agree. And I have a portfolio company called Abra. And they're not in Africa yet. They're in a few other emerging markets. But they're using the blockchain backend to transfer money much cheaper than the Western unions of the world. And I'll open up the Abra app here in the US. I'll send money to someone in Mexico. And then they'll open up the app, see how much money they've received. And they'll see on the app the network of tellers around them. That they can cash out the transaction.
Is it like a person could walk up to you with cash, like Uber?
Yeah, it's the Uber. I mean, they're using the interfaces that we're using, and they call it the human ATM network.
Sounds dangerous.
Well, so far these agents and tellers are already out there, and so it's just digitizing that transaction and actually being able to keep track of it much more efficiently.
I think you can say
that about Uber.
We've got a question down the front here.
I'm a traditional lender. We're a company called D&D Leasing. And so as a bank, how are you finding the credit data you're actually getting? Are you finding that you have to create new models for small business, or are you using traditional models for data, for credit?
So I think there's 1,000 questions in this space. And to back up, I think if there was one thing that I would like us in Atlas Mara, I mean, there's many things we want to be known for, but if we could be known as the bank for business and the bank for trade, I think we would be making the biggest impact on the economy and the biggest impact on Africa. European banks have pulled out from Basel III. Over 60% of the trade finance in Africa pre-crisis came from the European banks. Today it's about zero, maybe half of 1%. So we have a mission here. And I think what I said is true. And in the first 6 months of this year, higher loans, lower non-performing loans, better collections. We have put, 50 very talented people in a reasonably small bank at this point in a special unit that's really end-to-end changing the whole credit process. So I think it can be done. You have to have personal relationships with a lot of the smaller businesses. I don't think it lends itself right now to some of the technology that we're talking about, because I think it is very much bankers working with small businesses to understand. But I think this is the most important, and I do think technology will come into it. The second thing I would say is we're working very, very hard with the African Development Bank, local governments, and other DFIs, develop finance initiatives. And if we can get kind of a first loss on SMEs, it would really encourage lower rates of lending, and it would give us that comfort of credit that we need to really, really push lending. And I think that there's a lot of receptivity. We're not getting as much progress so far as we want. But lending to the small, to the African small business segment is the most important initiative we have.
Is there a thought to maybe work the way the UK works, where you've got like a Barclays lending to an intermediary bank, then the intermediary bank then lending to the SME, and that intermediary taking the stop loss?
I wasn't even aware of that Barclays did that, to be honest. But I don't see why that wouldn't work. If there was if there were smaller banks that specialized in that credit process, I don't know why that wouldn't work.
Okay, so we're pretty much out of time. So I wanted to ask each of you to be benevolent to other people who are looking at fintech and to say, is there one piece of advice from what you've learned about doing fintech in the developing world that you would think that people in the developed world ought to learn from what you've done? So I'll start with you, Taya.
Yeah, I mean, thank you, Matt. I mean, I think the one thing I would say is it shouldn't be technology for the sake of technology. And you really have to say what's appropriate in this market that I'm in, what do people understand, and what do you want to get to? So one example for us, when I started Paga, there were no examples of going to an agent and giving them cash to perform the transaction for you. It was all give the agent cash, it goes into your wallet, and you perform the transaction yourself using your phone. And thus the concept of mobile money. And in Nigeria, what people, culturally people are used to, the idea of sending people on errands and having someone do things for them, there's a trust in there. And so we leverage that knowledge, that local knowledge, to say, you know what, our agents should perform transactions for people. And I think that's something that, we're very proud of, that we've been able to do and scale a business on. So I think just the idea of not technology for the sake of technology and just making sure that it's appropriate in the market.
Shall I?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with that. And I think I always think of a lot of the emerging markets as a whiteboard, and we come with so many constraints because of these legacy infrastructures and ways of doing business. And I always tell entrepreneurs, just think about removing all those constraints. In a perfect world, how would you operate? What would you build? And what do people need first and foremost? And then work kind of backwards from there, because there's a lot that technology can actually do now that wasn't possible before that can help remove some of those constraints. But and that's what's so exciting about working with the emerging markets.
Matt?
I'd say the biggest lesson I've had in the last 6 months is just the hugeness of the opportunity. And the first night I put my app on the Google Play Store, put it on Facebook, went to bed, I woke up and 1,000 people had downloaded this really crappy app that I had made as like a minimal viable product. And I just, right then and there, the light bulb went on. We are reaching people who are yearning for modern financial services.
But do you think that translates across to the richer countries, if you're giving advice for them?
Yeah, I think I'm not as excited about working in richer countries, so I might be the wrong person to ask, because I think a lot of the innovations you're seeing in fintech over here are incremental, and you're slightly improving something and giving a product to a group of people that already are served. And typically, you're often reaching subprime borrowers in lending in the US online. Whereas in Africa and the emerging markets, the prime borrowers are still underserved. And so if you put up something online, you're going to reach the prime borrowers. It's like issuing the first Diners Club card in the 1950s, or the first Visa, or the first Amex. People are excited to have it, and you're reaching good borrowers who have a healthy relationship with finance.
Bob, some advice for your old friends at Barclays?
I think to me, the single most important lens we look at is, does this innovation allow us to get to the unbanked? It goes back to my first point. Somewhere between 75 and 85% of the people who live in sub-Saharan Africa have never been in a branch. So trying to get, whether it's a small business or a consumer, to people that don't have access to finances is the lens we look at.
Do you think, as you look at, say, America, where you have all this issue about payday lending and unbanking in America, I mean, are the same, you think there's an opportunity for banks to bring
Absolutely.
That perspective to bear here?
Absolutely. It won't have the impact that we're having here. I mean, we don't have a landline in our home in New York. Who would have thought of that when I was growing up? But it took a long time to get rid of that landline phone. When you do banking with someone who's never been in a branch, they're probably never going to go in a branch. So I just think it's going to take a lot longer in the developed economies.
Well, thank you. I think this has been a really exciting and visionary panel. So I appreciate you all for sharing with us. And I'd like to thank the panel and welcome everyone to join us for lunch outside. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.